Hi guys, Squirrel here. Year of the Squirrel is upon us, and this is the kit that is going to power my new gaming rig in 2015. There's a lot of great games coming. I'm really pumped for 2015, and this is my first build in a few years, actually. So I'm going to take you through the whole build. We'll start by taking a look at all of the individual components, and right at the end of the video, you should see the whole thing assembled and hopefully working. Alright, for the case, I've gone for the Cooler Master CM Storm Enforcer. Now, as you can see, it's got a number of features that I quite like. I've had this case before, it works really well. Down the front here, the air intakes, it's got a large fan behind there that draws air in, and it actually glows red. So I'm going for a very red-black theme, as you'll see with all the other components. Here's the drive bay, it has various slots here. There's going to be the DVD drive's going to sit there. Not going to use anything else. Could put a memory reader there, but I'm not too fussed about that. USB 3 ports up here, USB 2 ports, power, resets here, so it's hard to sort of do it accidentally. On the top, you can see there's a very large heat dissipation grill. So all the heat can basically be drawn in through, the cool air gets drawn in through here, rises up through the top there. It provides fantastic cooling. There's even plenty of holes on the top here if you want to do, you know, other kind of mountings, but I'm not going to bother with that. If we open the case, you'll see what you've got inside. These are the bays. They've all got quick release mechanisms on them so that you can remove the drives if you want to. Down here, you've got your standard 3.5-inch bays so that you can put SSDs, so I'll stack SSDs down there. They're all cooled by the air intake should you need it. What else have we got? We've got, oh yes, there's a fan up here, which is another extractor fan. That's not going to get used. I'm going to take that off, and that's where my fan will be for my CPU water cooler, which I'll show you in a second. Other than that, it's all very standard stuff. Comes with a whole bunch of drive bays. They're all quick release, so they just pop out like that, remove the drive, no problem at all. That's it. It's a beautiful case. It's black. It's got a side panel which allows you to see the components. Good ventilation. Quite modular. And I've had it before. So that is the CM Storm Enforcer case. On the power side of things, I'm a bit of a Corsair guy. I've had Corsair power supplies before. They've been very, very reliable for me. I've gone for the Corsair RM850. This is obviously an 850 watt power supply. It's optimized for silence. It's got zero RPM fans that will stay on under low load. There will be no fan turning whatsoever. So you get really super quiet, effective power supply. It's also Gold Plus rated, which means it, even when the fan's going, it's extremely quiet. It's completely modular, as you'll see here. This is the actual power supply. You can see it has this quite massive silent fan on top. That's the external thing there, and inside, turn it around, you'll see you've got everything you need for peripherals and SATAs, the ATX board, PCIe for the graphics card and so on. The cables themselves are flat, and this means that you can route them around the case very effectively, and you won't see them once they're all installed properly. But you can see this is what it means by modular. You only install the case, the cables that you actually need. And you get quite a lot of cables with this thing. Power supplies, some free cable ties, some screws to mount it with, and a lovely Corsair sticker to go on your case if you really want that kind of thing. So that's the power. Should do everything I throw at it. RM850 Corsair Series Ultra Quiet. So this is the motherboard. This is the Asus Maximus 7 Hero motherboard. It's one of the Republic of Gamers series. You'll see a bit of that later as I use the a few Republic of Gamer kit from Asus. Very nice stuff. If we just have a quick look at the specs on the back. So in terms of CPU, it takes the Intel LJ1150, so either a Core 5 or a Core 7. I'm going to use the i7 processor. It has the Z97 Intel Express chipset. Takes 4 DIMMs, anything up to 32GB DDR3. Maximum overclocked memory speed is 3200. I'm just going to go with 2400. That's more than adequate and should keep me nice and stable as well. Expansion slots on the back, two PCIe's, expansion slots inside, two PCIe's times 16, one PCIe slot and three PCIe 2.0 slots. It has integrated VGA graphics, pretty decent integrated VGA graphics to be honest, but Not of any interest to me. I'll be sticking a GTX 980 in there. In terms of support for multiple GPUs, it does support Intel SLI and AMD Crossfire. I'm not going to be using either of those. I've just got one 980 for now. But later, if I run out of power, I could always drop another 980 in there and SLI the two things up. We've got 6 USB 3 ports and 7 USB 2.0 ports. 8 SATA 6 gig ports, which is more than enough for what I need. We've also got a LAN. It's got like something called a networking for gamers LAN. So it kind of prioritizes packets for gaming, which is quite an interesting technology. Remains to be seen how useful it is, but it sounds pretty good to me. Audio, it's got Supreme FX audio 8-channel high definition, and it comes in the ATX standard form factor 12.9.6. It has a window on it, which is kind of cool. So you can just open it up like this and you can actually see inside. But let's just actually open it up properly. And if you wonder what this mat is, it's an anti-static mat. And this is an anti-static wristband. Because once you start handling electronic components, you really want to be grounded from static electricity because they will ruin your day. Well worth investing in one of those. So in the box, obviously we've got the manual. We've got CD with the drivers on. We've got the back plate, some SATA 6 cables already. That's good to see. Not sure what that is. Looks like some drop-in component. I'll have to read the manual to find out what that is. And that's obviously the SLI cable. Yep, the NVIDIA SLI cable. Now, in terms of the motherboard, I hope you can see this. Basically, there's a red-black theme going on here that I told you about before. So this motherboard is, I mean, seriously, it's a work of art, this thing. It's absolutely beautiful. And that's one of the reasons why I wanted the Storm Enforcer case, so that I can actually see into this. Red and black, I've bought red and black memory, and also the graphics card is red and black. You can see you've got these wonderful covers that just kind of, I don't know, it's not quite your normal motherboard, you know? It's very, very tidy, very neat. One of the interesting features it does have is the single release memory slots. I don't know if you know, but you know, a lot of memory banks, when you put the memory in, you've got to pull both ends in order to release it. With this, you just pop one and the whole thing will just come out. So that's a nice little feature. Obviously, the PCI slots are here. That's where the CPU is going to sit, which we'll go and take a look at now. But in terms of the back plate, you can see the back cover's there. Standard USB 3 is down the bottom. VGA, DVI out. It's got a shielded LAN as well, and there's your sort of audio bank over here. So that's the motherboard, the Asus Maximus 7 Hero, part of the Republic of Gamers set. So let's go and have a look at what's going to go inside this thing. All right, so you've seen the motherboard. This is what I'm going to put in. This is the Intel i7 processor. This is the 4790K. Massively overclocked. I think it's overclocked up to over 4 gigahertz, if I remember. It is actually overclockable as well. 4 cores, 8-way multitask processing, turbo boost technology, you know, hyper-threading, the usual stuff. Supports 2-channel DDR3 and a 3-year lifetime warranty. It's one of the higher-end Intel processors because of its overclocking capabilities, so it's absolutely perfect for the setup I'm going to do with an overclocking motherboard. So that's that. I've also got some Arctic cooling paste, MX4 thermal compound, obviously very important. Got to put this in between whatever the heatsink looks like, the block on top of the CPU. So that's that. For the memory, I've gone for, again, Corsair Vengeance Pro DDR3 series. There's 2x8 gigabytes in here. So this block here is 16 gig. This block is 16 gig for a sum total of 32 gig of RAM at 2400 megahertz. Very high performance memory. Bought them together as a set, which is another important thing to do when you buy memory, is to make sure you've got the same batch numbers, because there can be minor differences, and when you start overclocking memory at this kind of frequency, you know, timings can go and you get a bit of instability. So it's always best to order the same model and the same batch of memory when you're going to upgrade your PC. Just don't stick memory in later and hope that it's going to work. You're sort of rolling the dice if you do that. You're much better off just buying the memory in one unit. And if you want to upgrade later, put it to one side and get some more memory and upgrade it that way. So that's the CPU, that's the memory, that's the cooling paste. Let's have a look at what's going to cool that i7 down. All right, so we've got ourselves a monster CPU. We need something to cool it down. Now, you can just go for the standard fan approach. Works perfectly well. A little bit noisier. If you want to upgrade, this thing costs, I think, about £80, I seem to remember. This is the Corsair H80i. Works on Intel and AMD. You get various CPU and motherboard mounting brackets so that it works with multiple motherboards and CPUs. But they do make different models of this thing, so you're better off checking. It has to be the right type of processor. So they do make various models depending on what processor you're using. Because I'm using the LGA 1150, this is what's designed to work with that. And the thing is about this unit is you just buy it as one unit. It's a sealed unit. Now, remember I said to you, I'm going to be removing that fan on the back of the case. This is what sits on the back of that area there. This basically clamps onto the back of the case like that, and it'll sit like this. That'll turn and sit on the CPU itself. Now, what the idea is, you put one of these back plates on the back of the motherboard. This then screws down and clamps over the top of the processor. In the box, you get the standard cable which connects to the motherboard, so the motherboard can actually drive the fan. You get a whole bunch of screws, and then you get two fans. I'm going to use one fan, but you get an extra one anyway. I'm not sure why you get two. And then obviously you get the manual, the Intel Hydro series. And there you go. You can see on the diagram, hopefully, the fan sits over the block. Oh, there's a double fan, actually. That's the idea. There's twin fans sit around the block, and it goes onto the back of the case. I think you can get away with one fan, but, you know, we'll see. It's obviously recommending two. Obviously expecting quite a bit of heat. Water cooling is far more efficient than air cooling. The thing is about this setup is it will run very, very quietly, and you can overclock the processor and it will keep its temperature right down. It's a very efficient cooling system. So, the graphics card, very, very important. I've gone for an Asus Republic of Gamers Matrix Platinum graphics card. This is GeForce GTX 980, made by Asus. It's a very good card. If we just go through the specs quickly, it's an NVIDIA, obviously, GeForce GTX 980, PCI Express 3, has 4 gig of GDDR5 memory. The GPU is boosted to a clock of 1300 megahertz. The memory's running at 7,000 megahertz, which is absolutely incredible. Maximum resolution 4096 by 2160. I'm not going to be running it anywhere near that, but basically it's 4K compliance. In terms of the output, you can see here it's got a dual link DVI, a native HDMI 2, and 3 native DisplayPorts as well. Plenty of output capabilities. DisplayPorts started to become much more common these days, mostly because of the size of it. It has some memory defrosting capabilities on it, which I'm not really sure about, but it says out of the box, 13% faster, and it has a color-coded load indicator, which shows you how loaded the card itself is. In terms of what it looks like, this is what you get inside the box. It's again, red and black. It's a theme I've got going, and it's a beautiful piece of kit. There's no doubt about that. It's an absolute monster, but you can see it's also extremely nice looking. Two fans on it. It's basically enormous heat sinks. That's what it is. Republic of Gamers, Asus Matrix. Again, styling is a big thing. In terms of the display ports here, you've got the display ports and the HDMI and the DVI down there. So you can see it's a heck of a bit of kit. Very nicely presented in this wonderful box. You've got the Asus manual here, which tells you how to install it. And then you've got the various connectors here. So that's what's going to be powering my gaming. That is the GeForce GTX 980 from Asus, the Matrix Platinum 980 from Republic of Gamers. Wonderful bit of kit. Can't wait to see how that performs. Final piece of the jigsaw is the various bits and pieces, the peripherals. Now, for the keyboard, I'm just going to stick with my current keyboard, which you've probably seen on the stream. It's honestly, these are such good keyboards, mechanical gaming keyboards, the Illuminate Green. It comes with some very nice software that allows you to program the macro buttons. Really nice tactical but mechanical feel to them. Like I say, it's highly programmable and not too noisy. For mechanical keyboards, they're actually pretty quiet. That's the Acer Strix Tactic Pro keyboard, and thoroughly recommend that. In terms of the mouse, the Asus Gladius Republic of Gamers mouse. I used to use the Razer Death Adders, and then I came across these things. and I've not looked back. They're basically the same kind of size as a Death Adder, but they have some pretty interesting features to boot. And when you take it out the box, you get this little bag. It's like a travel bag, which is quite nice if you go gaming. And you might think to yourself, well, what about all the cables and stuff? Well, here's the really cool thing. This mouse comes with no cable connected, which is pretty unusual, which is what makes it a gaming mouse. And that's the stuff about the, you know, the whole Asus Republic of Gamers is the hardware specifically geared for gamers. So they know the problems, and they know that traveling is one of the things that people do when they're gaming. You know, they go to LAN parties or whatever. And basically what happens is you get this thing, and it pops in there. There's a little unlock switch there, and it locks it in. Plug it in with a USB cable. Off you go. Want to travel with it? Stick it in the bag. Take it to your mates or take it to your LAN party, and off you go. So that's the mouse. That is the Gladius mouse from Asus, Republic of Gamers. And for the hard drive, this is going to be my boot drive. This is the Samsung SSD 850 Evo. Now, I've used the 840 Evos. They've just moved on to the 850. It's got some 3D V9 technology. Pretty cutting-edge stuff from Samsung. You can't get that much better at the moment in terms of SSD performance. This is the 500 gig version. I've gone 500 gig for my boot drive. This is what I'm going to install the operating system onto. You can see I've already printed a label and stuck it on and says boot. Because when I open my machine up, I like to have all my drives labeled so I know exactly what they're doing. This is going to be the boot drive, like I say. There is a hard drive coming in from my current gaming rig, which is a Samsung 840 Evo. That's a 1 terabyte drive. That takes all of my games. So all my Steam games, all my, you know, FSX and all that stuff goes onto the 1 terabyte SSD. Gives you some pretty good launch performance when you're loading games and when it's loading in scenery, for example, Train Simulator loading scenery. Even though you still get a bit of lag, it's far less than if you had it on a hard drive. But you still need hard drives at the end of the day, and that's what these are. These are Seagate 2 terabyte drives. They run at, I think, is it 720K, these ones? I can't remember. The SATA 3, 6 gigabits. I think they run, it's not actually labeled. I can't remember what I ordered. I think they run at 7200 RPM. They're pretty fast drives. They have a cache as well built into them. There's two of these. Not decided if I'm going to use both in the gaming ring or just one. Like I say, so I'm going to go for this, for the boot drive. I'm going to go for 1 terabyte for the games. That will basically contain everything else. I may or may not put that in for backup. My other option is to back up to the cloud. So I'm not decided on that yet. But that will go into the streaming PC anyway, no matter what. Finally, Windows 8.1. Now, I've always used 7. I've never gone for 8, never gone for 8.1. Recently, I bought the kids some laptops that's got 8.1 on it. It seems pretty decent. But the main reason I'm going 8.1 rather than 7 is because you get increased driver performance out of some of this kit. And more importantly, the upgrade path to Windows 10 is a heck of a lot easier because the 8.1 already comes with the App Store and the cloud built in. And so the upgrade path to 10 is point and click and off you go. It should be very, very smooth, and 10's out later this year. And I'm definitely going to be going to Windows 10. 7 to 10 is a little bit harder. So I'm going for 8.1. If it turns out that it absolutely sucks and I hate it, I'm going to drop back to 7. So I'm going to see how it goes before I stick with 8.1. But I'm pretty certain it's going to be okay. It's probably going to be for no more than 6 months anyway. And then I'll drop to, upgrade to Windows 10. So that is all the bits and pieces. Yep, I've not missed anything else. Now it's time to start assembling the whole lot. We're going to start with the case and the power supply and the motherboard. So as you can see, case is open, the back panel's off. I've removed the fan from the rear of the case. I've installed the Corsair RM850. Quite simply, you just drop it in, 4 screws. The only thing to watch out for is the cooling fan must be on the bottom because that's where it draws its air in from the bottom of the case. There's actually holes at the bottom of the case there. So make sure you don't put that in upside down. This plate here is actually for 2.5-inch drives, like floppy drives, that kind of thing. 2 screws that pops out. I'm going to need to remove that anyway because it's not possible to access these modular power supply on the back of this thing unless I get rid of that. May not even put it back in, to be honest. It depends whether I want to put an SSD in there or leave it over in here. You have to screw them into to the actual pack. The pack comes out. So I think I may just put the SSDs into here just because they're easier to get at later. So I'll probably just remove that altogether. So I've got the motherboard. Here it is. Now, there are, I think, 8 or 9 holes, something around that mark, dotted around here. The thing to do now is to try and line those holes up with those, what do they call them, the spacers. I can't remember the actual name for those things. They're basically spacers, and they're not installed in the correct configuration because, obviously, the manufacturer doesn't know what motherboard you're getting. So they actually come in this pack here. So the next thing to do is work out where to put those in, and then a pair of pliers just to tighten them onto the case. So I'm going to do that next, and then we should be able to drop the motherboard and screw it onto the back of the case. You'll notice there's a giant hole at the back here. That's perfect because I will need to put the backing plate here, the backing bracket for the water cooler, and you need to get around the back. So that hole should allow me, even once this thing is on there, access to the rear. So I can actually put this in before I put the water cooler back plate on, which is kind of handy. So I'm just going to put those screws in now and then mount the motherboard onto the case. All right, so I've got the motherboard installed. These are the things I was talking about. They're called standoffs, not spacers. They're called standoffs. So I installed 9 of those in position, the 3 down the bottom, 3 across the middle, 3 across the top. And then what I've done is I put a screw in the middle there, and then each of the 4 corners, which is plenty of screw, to hold that. There was a back plate which had to go on first. Each motherboard comes with its own back plate. That just pushes straight into the back there, and then the motherboard just clicks into place. And then finally on the back, turn it around, you can see those are the 4 holes that I mentioned. This is where the back plate will go for the CPU cooler. So spin it back around again. Now we are ready to start installing the other bits and pieces. We've got cables to do, but we need to do the CPU next, then to get the cooler on top, and we'll obviously have to mount the cooler in here. Then we'll start connecting up all of these cables and think about some cable management. There's no point tying anything down at this stage. We've got plenty to do before then. Then we'll drop the memory in, and then the graphics card will go in there. And then we're pretty much getting there then. Once the power supply cabling, there's the ATX motherboard power supply, so we need to drop power supply cables from there to there. And then we need to decide the position of the graphics card. It's quite a long card. I may have to remove one of these drive cages in order to fit it in. We'll see how long it is. But let's move on to the next stage, which is the CPU and the cooler. Right, it's time to install the CPU. Now, I've got all the bits and pieces here. This is the water cooler. This is the processor. This is the thermal paste. However, having looked more closely and read the manual on the water cooler, I don't know if you can see it or not, but it actually comes with its own built-in thermal paste. So it turns out when you buy this water cooler, you don't need to buy thermal paste. So that's going. If we take a look at the processor, if we just pop this open, you can see it comes with a big manual and a heatsink and a processor. So I'm just going to go ahead and pop this open. I'm not going to be needing this. Eesh, really? Considering the price of this processor, I don't know. I suppose it's okay. I wouldn't use it. Right, let me get this open. There we go. All that money for this tiny little piece of amazing technology. So we're going to go ahead and put this into the motherboard in a second, but I thought I'd take you through the rest of the cooling bits before we do that. Now, this thing comes with 2 brackets, one for the AMD, one for the Intel. It's important to make sure you get the right thing. For the LGA 1150 processor, you need the back plate, and this is the front plate, which will sit on top of that thing and clamp it to that. That's how that's going to work. Processor, these are some spacers which are for the different Intel, the 2011, I think. We don't need that. We need these spacers. We're going to use those in a second. We've got some washers. We've got some screw nuts. These are going to hold the fans. And the thing to note about the fans is when you read the manual, it says it works best if the air comes into the case. So on top here, there's a couple of arrows, which basically says that the airflow is that way, which means I need to make sure that these stickers, not those, the ones with the white bits, these are on the inside so that the air is drawn into the case. So the way it works is you put one of these onto the inside of the case, and then you effectively get your next one and you screw it like that. That's how it works. So we're going to go through that as well. Comes with a whole bunch of screws and nuts for the cooling system. This goes onto, believe it or not, this cooling actually has two sockets on it. This goes off to the USB, I think, and this goes off. No, that goes to the USB, and that one goes off to the motherboard. We'll go through that in more detail. First thing I've got to do, though, is install this processor. Now, first thing, most important thing, before you touch anything electronic like this, make sure that you've got your grounding cable attached. And pretty straightforward, this bit, as long as you know, pay attention to a few things. First of all is you just got to pull that lever there. That then pulls back. The whole mount lifts up. Now, this plastic cover needs to be popped off. So just go ahead and pull that off. So now you can see the processor is going to go right in here. Now, the important thing to note about the processor, if we just get hold of it, is that it has a couple, and they're very hard to see, but it has a couple of tiny, tiny notches near the top, near one top edge, and that's the thing to look for. I don't know if you can see it or not, but just top left and top right, we can see a couple of little grooves there, and they line up to the two little grooves here. So basically, it's very hard to get it wrong, because if you get it wrong, it won't sit flush, and that's sitting quite flush there like that. There we go. That is it. That's processor installation. Make sure that that edge there goes underneath the nut. That's part of the clamping mechanism. And then the whole thing, when it's sitting flush, the whole thing should clamp down like that. And that's it. That's the processor in place. That's the Intel i7 in place. The next thing to do is to put the Corsair CPU cooler on top of that thing. Well, as you can see, I've put the radiator in and the fan behind it. Quite straightforward, really. It's just four screws and washers straight into the back of the case. Comes through and just clamps this thing on. The important thing to note, though, is that the pipes here need to be at the bottom side, not at the top side. That it helps if you rest this thing over here, and it also helps if you've got four pair of hands, but sadly, I don't have four pair of hands. So I had to just rest this thing over there while I clamp that lot on. So the only other thing now is to get this second fan on here, which goes there. Now, I think this is somewhat optional, perhaps a little bit of overkill. You could probably get away with that. I guess it depends how much overclocking you're going to do. The other thing to note is, like I said, make sure that that label's this way so the airflow is coming in. It will then vent out through the top there. And also, I've put it like this so that the cable is on top. Now, these two cables, and this is where I found out something interesting. These two cables go into this splitter, and this splitter then attaches to the top of the cooling block that sits on the radiator. Confused the hell out of me at first. This thing actually comes basically with these blocks on top. So I was looking at a female connector here and a female connector coming out the fan, and I couldn't for the life of me work out how that was meant to go. Turns out, it doesn't say this in the manual, but if you just pop that, the whole thing comes off. And I had to play around with it for 5 minutes to discover this. But then you end up with a male connector, which obviously sits inside the female connector. That then goes into the top of the block. So we've got the radiator on. We need to put the back plate. We've got the radiator up here. We need to put the back plate on there. Get this thing clamped on. Remember, there's no thermal paste required. Once we get that thing clamped on there, we'll then be able to make these cabling connections. We'll worry about tidying the cables up a little bit later. Obviously, you've got to think ahead roughly where you want cables to be going, but there's no point tying everything together until the installation's complete and you know that the computer actually works. So we're going to end up with a big mess at the moment, but that's fine. Right, so now we are at the most trickiest part of this installation. The reason it's so tricky is because what we've got to do is we've got to get this block, when these pipes are fighting against us, but we've got to get this block, and you can see I've put the mounting bracket on there. I should point out that the back plate is installed. It literally just pops in, and then you put these spacers in, tighten them up. So this bracket that I showed you earlier now sits on top of the cooler, and you can see the pipes are fighting me. That is then going to push down and sit, and we're going to tighten up these four screws on top. Now you see they've got a crosshead on them, So we're going to finger tighten them up, and then we're going to have to get the screwdriver ready and cross tighten them in. Now, we only really get one shot at this, because what we can't do is, if when we put the block on top of the CPU, the thermal paste, which is on here already, is going to make contact. And the point where it makes contact, we're going to have to push and hold and put those four screws on. We cannot lift any part of it off. If we lift any part of it, it will create an air pocket, and we'll have to clean all the thermal paste off the CPU and the block and start again. I really don't want to do that. So I'm going to basically get this thing into position, push it on, and then start to put these four screws on. So I'm going to have everything ready to go. Like I say, if you've got four pair of hands, really helps at this point, but I don't. I suspect you don't either. So here we go. I'm going to remove the cover. Make sure we keep the bracket on top. Bracket's on top. Let's remove the plastic cover now. Make sure the pipes are towards the memory module, and then position. And lower into place. Now it's in place, it's riding around a little bit. That's fine, as long as we don't lift anything off, we'll be fine. So now we tighten in screw number one. Finger tight will do at this stage. Number two. And reach around, keeping pressure on the block at all times. Reach around for number three, which is obviously getting more and more tricky, especially with cables in the way. Once we've got three on, we're in a better position. Just three will maintain a good contact. So that's the third one on. Keeping the pressure on. And then we come in for the fourth and final. There we go, right. Still maintaining some pressure. I'm now going to tighten opposite ends. Now you want this thing to be tight, but bear in mind, you are dealing with electronic components here. So do not over tighten them. It's tight, but not stupidly tight. That's that. That is now firmly clamped into position. That's the cooling block installed. I'm just going to put the next radiator on here. Couldn't really do that while we were doing all this because it was getting a bit messy. So if I get my other fan, which is this one here. Now, if you remember, that sticker goes on the inside like that. So that's going to basically go on here. We've got four screws that go into the top. Two on the top there. I'll just finger tighten that on. We get that one in, it'll hold it. Another one down the bottom there. And the fourth one. Now you can't turn these in very much because they start to hit the metal, and at that point you need a screwdriver to tighten them up properly. That just clamps on like that. Now you don't have to use the Corsair fans that come with this. If you want, you could go for your favorite ones. I used to like Noctua ones. Noctua ones are very silent. Don't know how quiet these are going to be. Corsair tend to make good stuff, so I'm hoping they're going to be reasonably quiet. But if not, it's not particularly difficult to swap them out later on. Is that held in? Yes, it is. So now we've got this cable. We've got two fan cables coming up the back here. One's from the rear fan, one is from the front fan. And we've got some cabling to do now, so we're going to do that next. But I need to just quickly work out which ports I'm going to connect things to. So I'll show you that now. Right, so I've turned the case around so that you can see what's going on a bit better. You can see what we've got is we've got this thing hanging off the cooling block. We've got our two fan cables here, and final bits are to install for the Corsa water cooler are these two cables here. Now, what happens is, first of all, we need to connect this Y-splitter cable to each of our cooling fans on the radiator. And they just pop into there like so. This now installs into the top of here, but it's kind of hard to see what's going on. So I'm going to have to reach over and find the installation point. Right, so that was a bit of a joke trying to reach that, but I've connected that cable and you can see the Y splitter comes in and connects into the top right of the block. I'm just going to move that out of the way. We'll do some cable management later, as I say, so that's very untidy at the moment, but we'll sort that out. Now, in terms of the other one, what we've got here is a couple of things. We've got this SATA power and this CPU header. Now, basically, on the top of this particular Hero motherboard, you can see there's a CPU fan and a CPU optional fan. It doesn't really matter which one it goes into. It just needs to go into one of them. So I'm going to pop that. Let's move that cable out of the way. I'm going to pop that into CPU fan, like so. Now, what I also did was down the power supply, remember it's modular, I got one of the SATA cables, and you can see I've plugged it into the SATA peripheral point, and I've routed it around the back of the chassis, so it comes back out here. Now, obviously the DVD drive is going to go here, so that will power one of them. So I'm just going to take the first one and connect it onto that. Actually, maybe the second one might be a better option. Give us a bit more cable management options later. So we just need to plug that into here. So that end piece there will obviously go into the DVD drive, which I'm going to put into the top there. That's almost it. There's one more thing to do, and that is to get the other cable. This is the USB cable. So this thing has another connector on here, which is a USB connector. This needs to connect into the top of the block, and it needs to plug into one of the motherboard USB points. Now you can see I've got two down here. Really don't want to do this, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to put the cable around the back and come underneath and then plug into here like that from the top end. Be a much tidier installation. The point of the USB connection is that it allows you to sort of monitor and control what the water cooler is doing from inside your operating system, which is quite handy. So slightly incorrect, the USB cable actually comes into the side here. There's another connector there. I'm not really sure what that one's for. It's not used according to the manual. The cable comes into here and the USB cable comes into that side there. So apart from the messy cable situation, that completes the installation of the Corsair H80i cooler and the Intel i7-4790K processor. Next thing to do is to drop some memory modules into here, and then to start connecting up some of the motherboard to case cables, which I'll need to go and refer to the motherboard manual for to make sure we make the correct connections. After that, once we've got to get the rest of the power onto the motherboard, we've got a hard drive to put in, graphics card to drop in, and then we'll be ready to turn this thing on and see what happens. Right, decided to put the memory in first. These are the memory blocks. There's going to be four in there. Pretty straightforward installation, nothing special about these. Again, don't touch the edge connectors, make sure you're grounded, usual stuff. And like I say, simple enough installation. You just got to look for that notch there, which corresponds to that notch here. So we'll just open up the arm that grabs hold of its thing, and we'll drop that one in first, get the one nearest the pipe. Push it and so you hear that click. If you've only got two of these, if you're only putting two in, you must use the colour-coded memory banks. Either put two into the red or put two into the black. You must pair these things up. They have to be paired. Full memory banks. Now, they're going to need some decent cooling because they are overclocked, but they've got these metal radiators on them. And again, that fan there, which is blowing air in, is going to help to keep that thing cooled, and then the heat will vent out that way. So that completes the memory installation. So I have gone ahead and cabled everything up. So I've got the ATX power in here. We've got the USB 3 connector to the chassis in here. You can see I've tidied these cables up a little bit. I drew the speaker cables around the back of the chassis there. A lot of cables are hidden behind the motherboard, which is pretty much what we want, because the rear of the case is not transparent, whereas this side is. And so when we look in here, you know, we want to see a nice tidy job. But like I said, I've not tidied everything up fully yet. So I've gone ahead and added another SATA cable here, which is coming through there. That's going to power the SDD and the hard drive that I'm going to install, which I'm going to do next. You can see I've connected up the various chassis, like the power switch and the LED light and all the rest of it. This down here is another USB 2.0. So the front of the case supports 2.0 and 3.0 USB. That's the 2.0, that's the 3.0. I have to say, I don't really like the 3.0 cable. It's a little bit too much play in it, and it's a little bit easy to come out. It doesn't click in. These kind of connectors push in, although they're a bit ugly, they do actually hold in position quite well. You know, because when if you're installing a new hard drive later or something, you might knock a cable, and this seems to me could very easily just knock straight out of there, whereas everything else is quite firmly held in place. So I've taken my Samsung Evo and I've mounted it inside this plastic mount that comes with the motherboard. You want to get one of these. So if you need to get more, you can actually buy them online, these SSD converters. Or as I say, you can actually not put them in these racks. You can put them straight in to this thing, which is designed for floppy drives and SSDs, and that clamps down there. I personally don't like this. It kind of gets in the way of the power supply, so I'm not that happy with it. But you know, for this SSD, I've just put it in this bracket. And what we do now is we get these rails. The motherboard comes with plenty of these. They just push into the side, like so, and then you just drop the drive into the slot that you want it in. So I'm going to go around about. You'll line it up properly, like that. Pushes in and clicks into place. So now I've just got to put the SATA cable in, the SATA power in at the back. And again, the motherboard comes with a bunch of these SATA 6 cables. So the SATA block is here. You can see I've installed the DVD drive up here, so I've got the SATA cable coming down there. But yeah, we're kind of getting there. You know, that's, once we've got the drives in place, then the only thing left is going to be the graphics card, which is obviously going to sit here. That's probably going to be in the way looking at it. Graphics card's going to go here. It's quite long. I'm hoping I don't need to get rid of that chassis. But we'll see. I'll get this all in place and then we'll start on the graphics card. Right, so I took the graphics card out of the box, and not entirely surprisingly, it's a little bit too long. As you can see, when it's slotted in here, the back end of that, this bit that sticks out particularly, was in the drive cage. So I've had to remove the drive cage, which basically meant that I had to rejig the hard drives around. So what I've done is I've taken that drive cage, the mini one that was mounted down here originally, and it actually screws on top of this larger drive cage. So that's quite a handy design. So I've basically taken the SSD out of that mounting bracket and popped it into that drive cage here. It's just held here with two screws, which is absolutely fine. It means just two screws to quick release it. And I've taken the hard drive and I've put it into the larger cage here. So I've got two hard drives at the moment with a space for another SSD and another full-size drive. After that, I'm going to struggle a little bit. There's nowhere else to basically put drives apart from in this cage here. But I would need to get the 5.25-inch wide mounting cases that take the hard drive and will fit there. So what I've got to do now is I've got to put the graphics card in here. So I'm going to have to undo these two expansion slots and fit the graphics card into here and then power it all up. Right, so I've removed these two expansion plates. I'm just going to get the card here. Right, is the monster. Now, important things to note are, there's the SLI on the top. The power supply is here. So that means the card's going to sit in this way, and we've got to get two 2x4 powers over to here. Now, I've got the power cable here for that. This one. Basically, each end has the 2x4 connectors on it, the PCIe connectors. They're quite standard. And then the other end just plugs straight into the power supply. It comes with some, the actual card comes with these, but there's just no way that they're going to fit. They're not long enough. These would be about twice as long as that. And then, interestingly enough, I've noticed there's also a Molex power supply here. So I'm going to have to run another power cable out of the power unit into the Molex. I could potentially use a SATA to Molex, but I don't have an adapter free. So I'm going to have to use the power cable for that. So let's just get this thing slotted in there. Make sure the lever is down. Line it up. Just give it a gentle pull to make sure it's locked in, which it is. So I just need to screw that back in there now. On the screwdriver. And then it takes up two expansion slots, as you would expect. This thing is an absolute monster of a card. Very useful having magnetic screwdrivers. Really, really useful for when you're doing PCs. Inevitably, you drop screws in there. I've done it a number of times already, and it's really handy to just be able to put the screwdriver and just lift it out. Okay, that is now well and truly locked in place. So now we've got to get the power cable, and there are actually, on this thing, there are the two ones at the top are the PCIe. There's actually two of them, obviously, if you're going to run an SLI configuration. You need more power. You certainly need a bigger graphics, a big power supply. This one's more than up to the job. There we go. And you can see I can actually get this thing tucked in down there later. Probably run it along like that, maybe along the edge. There's only so much you can do. Unfortunately, cables are inevitable in any PC setup, but cable management, like a really good system, will have fantastic cable management on the inside. I've seen some amazing professional jobs. I don't think I'm going to achieve that kind of level, but I'll certainly do a decent job of it. So we need to drop that into one of the PCIe. There we go. And that's why Molex connectors are not that popular anymore, because they don't click into place, they push into place, and they're pushing very tightly. And although this thing does have these springy things, it helps to stop it from falling out. The older ones used to just fall out, quite literally. Right. So, we're pretty much done. So, we're at the point now where we're going to have to fire this thing on. I always hate the first time you throw the switch. You never know what's going to happen. I've had everything from fried CPUs to absolute silence when you think, what have I done wrong? Which cable have I not plugged in? What have I not switched? Never forget that the power supplies have a switch on the back as well. That's the classic one. This motherboard, you can actually start it from that button though, bizarrely enough. So the thing to do now is to just finally just go around every single connection, check everything is pushed in firmly. Because inevitably you will unseat something that should have been seated. If you see any cables lying around, not plugged in anywhere, you need to ask yourself, should that be plugged in somewhere? Those cables there, for example, have just managed to push their way through. That one had just pushed its way towards the fan. So when I turn the fan on, it would start to hit that. So we'll keep that out of the way until we manage the cables later. SATA's not so bad. I've got all the SATA connected, but if one of those wasn't connected, it just wouldn't recognize the drive. That's absolutely fine. It's not a critical thing. But yeah, I believe we're done. We're ready to get the monitor, get the keyboard and mouse, and fire this thing up and see what happens. Wish me luck. Right, I've spent some time. I've done some cable management. You can see what I've done up at the top there. I've tidied all the cables up. I'll talk about in a second a change that I've made to do with a splitter cable, which I'll just find, which is this splitter cable. But first, I just want to show you what I've done. I've tidied all the cables up there. They're all going out the back. On the back, they're actually tied up against the case to keep them all nice and firmly in position. The USB cable that I was worried about is actually clamped to the case as well to effectively pull it towards the case and minimize the chance of it just popping off the motherboard. It really doesn't click in. It's not a good design at all. But I've tidied up all the cables. You can see all these cables down here are all nicely tidied up. If I just move the camera down, you can see down the bottom there. There we go. You can see down here the graphics card. All the cables coming out the power supply. Now the Corsair, obviously, the flat cables, they stack on top of each other and then you can just cable tie them together. Really nice design. Here is the hard drives, the SSD and the hard drive itself. Now I've got another SSD to come in here and another hard drive to go in here. So what I've also done while I was doing cable management is I've left myself another two connected SATA cables, SATA data cables, and just in there is another two SATA power cables, so that I won't have to cut any cable ties and mess about with the cable management in order to fit those extra hard drives. So I've kind of allowed a little bit for what I want to do shortly. Other than that, you can see all of the cables are essentially tied away. It's all looking great now. Even on the back plate, when you take the back plate off, which I won't do, but when you take the back plate off, it's all nicely cabled against the chassis, so there's no possibility of things getting snagged. Everything's nice and tidy. Now, there is something that I want to do next, but let me just talk about what I said I've done up here. Now, if you look carefully, and this is going to be a memory test for you, but if you look carefully, you will see that there is no extra cable coming out of the top of the water cooler block. If you remember, I had this cable, this Y splitter cable. It came out of the top of the block and the two endpoints connected to the two fans on the water cooler radiator. I had a chat with my technical guy at Asus, or Asus if you want to prefer to call it that way. I had a chat with my technical guy about this, and he said to me, because I kind of said to him that these fans are very noisy, they sound like a turbine. And as you can probably hear now, they're actually very quiet. What he said was, get rid of this, get rid of the Y connector, and instead take the two CPU radiator fans and drop them up here. Now there's two connections on the motherboard, one's called CPU and one's called CPU opt. It's the optional connector. Essentially, you drop both connections onto the motherboard, and then you use the AI suite tools to configure the fans, and therefore the AI software, the motherboard, will then control the fans rather than that block with its jiggery pokery inside of it. It works a lot better, but I'm not going to stop there because I still don't like the sound of these fans. These fans, although they're very good at what they do, when you stress test, they sound a bit whiny. And I thought to myself, you know what, I want something a bit better than that. Cooler Master fans, I think, are slightly quieter than Corsair ones, but I'm going to find out. So what I've done is I've purchased two of these. Let me just pan back a little bit. I've purchased two of these. These are Cooler Master Sickle Flow 120 2000 RPM red LED fans. Now, they're available in different colours. Obviously, I've gone for the red LED. Now, again, I had a chat with my Asus tech guy, and here's the thing, guys, you can't just take standard case fans and stick them onto this radiator block, because the fans that push air through this radiator have to have enough pressure. The blades angle differently. They have to force the air through this cooling block. And standard case fans are not designed to kind of match, you know, meet any resistance. They just push air into the case or out of the case. Whereas these things are designed to push air through a series of very small fin radiators. And he said to me, you need to check. So he had a look at the pressure on the back, and it's 2.94 millimeter H2O, which, you know, I'll be honest with you, I understand what that measurement means, but I don't know if that's enough pressure. But he said to me, that's fine. He said that'll be more than adequate for what you need. So the last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to take this block back off again. I'm going to replace these two things with these fans. They'll glow red, and hopefully they'll be a bit quieter. So I'm going to do that, and then the final thing I'm going to do is I'm going to show you the configuration tools I've been using, because when I replace the fans, I'll have to tune the fans again with the AI software. It's quite a simple process, but when you've done that, you can pick your configuration profile, so you can set when the fans speed up and what kind of cooling they give the CPU at a given temperature. So I'll take you through that, and then I'm going to overclock the CPU a little bit more. I've got it clocked at 46 times core speed currently, which is giving me a 4.7 gigahertz rating. I'm going to go for a 47 overclock, which will give me almost a 4.8 gigahertz rating. The important thing is that that water cooler needs to keep the temperature of the CPU down to around about 70, maximum 75, when the CPU is 100% stressed. If it can do that, then we can stay at 47, assuming that the stress test runs stably. But yeah, we'll go through that in a minute. I'm going to basically swap these fans out, and then we'll take a look and have a listen to what it sounds like with the new fans on. Well, the new fans are in place. You can see them here. You can see the glow of the red LED. It's quite subtle. Can't really see it under this very strong studio lighting that I've got here. But when the case is back on and, you know, we're at night and all the rest of it, inside is going to glow quite nicely now because of the large case fan has red LEDs on it. And now these fans have red LEDs on it. And obviously we've gone for a red and black look. So the whole thing's looking quite tidy. I can tell you that these fans are actually very, very quiet. Really quiet. How do they perform? Well, that's another question. I've had a very quick go of them just to make sure that they're quite stable. And I can report that they are. They're a really good replacement for the Corsairs that I took off. One thing to note is this thing. The end of the Corsair fan is actually a 4-pin. This is a 4-pin connector. And the Cooler Master ones that I put in are a 3-pin. The only thing to note there is that when you plug them in, you need to go into the BIOS and go under the QFan control and select DC rather than PWMC, I think it is. Basically, it tells you in the BIOS, if you're using 4-pin connectors, use PWMC, I think it's called that. And if you're using 3-pin connectors, use DC connector. Use the DC option. So I had to switch that to DC. But apart from that, it literally is a drop-in replacement for the Corsair fans. And they're definitely quieter. And then went into the BIOS and went through and made sure everything was okay. If you notice here, the DDR3 RAM is set to 2400. Now, the memory is actually rated at 2400. But we can go into this easy tuning wizard and it will give us a little bit of an overclock. As you can see, the bus clock is running at 100 megahertz. That means with a ratio of 40, the CPU run at 4000 megahertz or 4 gigahertz. But with the tuning wizard, you can go through and say, what type of fan have you got? You say, I've got a water cooler. It says out the door, it can probably get a 15% boost on your CPU and 84% boost on DRAM, which is quite an interesting boost. So here we are, back in the BIOS, and you notice straight away, top right, it says 4.4080 megahertz CPU, and the memory is now clocked at 2448. What it's done is it's moved the bus clock up to 102 megahertz. Now the bus dictates everything. So that dictates the RAM and the CPU multipliers. So the RAM is now running a little bit faster. We're running at 1.65 DRAM voltage, and the memory frequency is now 2448 megahertz. Now at the top here, it says the target CPU is 4590 megahertz. So it reckons it can overclock the CPU up to about 4.6 gigahertz, around that kind of mark. So what I did next was I went through, you know, basic SATA configuration, just made sure it had found all of my hard drives. It's found my SSD, it's found the hard drive itself, it's even found the DVD-ROM, which is very useful when you come to install Windows. So I was just quickly checking through, having a read, make sure that everything was all connected, it found all the devices. If I didn't see a device that I was expecting, I probably forgot to plug in a power supply or a cable had fallen out. Check the onboard devices, very important. Make sure, you know, if you want to turn off the audio, this is the point where you'll do it inside the configuration here. And also your LAN and all that kind of thing, PCI Express. This, you know, basic stuff really. There's nothing monstrously difficult about any of this. And what I'm going to do now is just save this profile. I'm going to give it a name. This is our kind of very, very starter, basic overclocking to bring us up to 4.6 gigahertz. So I'm going to give it a name, and I'll use this profile to install the operating system next, because the operating system will give us a lot more tools for configuring, tweaking, and testing our overclocking abilities. But for now, we're going to go with this as a basic profile, which we know works, and we can always come back to later if we mess up some of the configuration. After I'd done all that, I basically stuck in the Windows 8.1 DVD, booted it up, went for a nice clean install on my SSD, and then stuck in my motherboard support DVD that came with the Asus motherboard. This contains all of the chipset drivers and device drivers and all the rest of the things I need to get the operating system to work with the motherboard. It also contains the Asus tools that I will use to control the fans and to tweak things and monitor things. So I stuck the DVD in, run setup, and started going through the installation process. And then I set upon installing the various drivers. You just need to work your way through these things. There's LAN drivers, there's Realtek audio drivers. There's a lot of stuff. You need to consider each one. For example, Kaspersky antivirus, I don't want that. You're not necessarily going to need all of this stuff, but I do recommend you install the AI Suite 3. That contains the complete set of tools that you can use to monitor and tweak what's going on with your computer. Very, very handy. So just work your way through this, get all this stuff installed, and then we'll go through tweaking how to get the best out of the machine in a second. Here we are. This is filming my desktop. I don't have a capture card set up yet, so I can't capture this, so I'm literally filming my screen. So apologize if it does flicker or the quality isn't fantastic, but hopefully you'll be able to see what I'm doing. This is the AI Suite. You access it by running the AI Suite tool. There it is, AI Suite 3. It comes with the Asus motherboard, and it's quite a good tool. I have to say, it's quite a good tool. This is the thing we want. This is the Fan Expert. Now, down the bottom, pay attention here. This is the CPU temperature currently, 33 degrees, 600 RPM. That's really slow. That radiator block is really good at keeping the CPU cool. But also, the i7 processor is very, very efficient when you're not pushing it, so it's consuming minimal wattage. As you can see here, 6.6 watts is all the power it's taking at the moment. So let's click on this, and we're going to go into the fan control. Now, if you change your fans, and this thing controls CPU fans, chassis fans, all the rest of it, the moment you change any of the fans, you immediately have to go into fan tuning. What fan tuning is going to do is run the fans through a series of tests all the way maximum speed right down to rest, and it's going to monitor the system and see how the CPU temperature changes as it loads it. And what you need to do is click on that, say, do you want to continue? Yes. And you sit back and you wait. And it does point out here, when you're using a 3-pin CPU fan, set the CPU Q control to advanced. That is something that I was telling you about a second ago. We are now using 3-pin fans, and so you do need to go into Q fan control and change the settings. But you can hear, hopefully, the fans have kicked off, and it's gradually bringing the speed down of the fan, and it's monitoring and measuring what that does to the CPU and also to the case fans. So it's quite good. We'll just let it run through, and then we'll carry on. Well, it finished, and here are the results. Now, this, it builds up a curve here. Basically, what happens as the fan speed increases versus what happens with the temperature of the CPU, or rather the power that's being drawn by the CPU. And you can see what's going on here. The RPM is increasing here as a percentage of power is input there. It says the value indicates the rise in CPU temperature for every 1 watt of power that the CPU consumes. A low value denotes a good CPU cooling environment, which can be achieved via the Asus Fan Expert 3, which is what we're doing. Bottom line is, it ran through that control, and when we click on OK, we can now click into here, and we can control this if we want to. Now, there are different settings that we can go for. If you drop back, we've got silent, standard, turbo, or full. Now, watch this curve here. If I click on silent, what that did was it made the fan start to increase in power and speed when the CPU reaches 50 degrees. Okay, so it considers the blue area to be fine. We don't need much fan speed. Very, very, very quiet fan. All the way up to 50 degrees, at which point it starts to ramp it up to 70. Now, that's obviously the silent. If we go for turbo, for example, you see the profile very different. At this point, it will start to ramp up the fan speed when the CPU hits 25 degrees. Now, the yellow dot there indicates where we currently are, currently here at 32. So already it will have increased the fan speed a little bit, but you can't hear it. The Cooler Master Fan is so good, you just can't hear it. I prefer this kind of profile, turbo, because I am heavily going to overclock my processor. So again, if you go full speed, you can hear that possibly. It's flatlined the fan, but that's maximum fan, and that's not outrageous. But you click on turbo and you'll see the temperature come careering back down. This is the current fan speed now. There we go. Lovely and quiet. And you can do that for all the fans. This is the chassis fan. You can set a configuration for the chassis fan. You can set a configuration for the CPU fan. All depends on your environment and what you're trying to do. So personally, I'm going to stick with turbo. I like the turbo option. Idles at around 31 degrees, but it's so quiet. I could get this under 30 if I wanted to, at the expense of some more fan noise. But 30 is absolutely fine. So if you want to, you can just go ahead and save that. We could call that CPU turbo squirrel. Not enough letters, CPU turbo squirrel. There you go. Save that. So now we've got a profile we can come back to later. However, there's something else I want to show you. So that's just the fan control in AI Suite 3. There is also this tool from Intel, which you can download. It's called the Extreme Tuning Utility. And it's very good, really good, very useful. And again, it's shown the CPU temperature down here. What it does is let us test things. Now, top right there, you can see we're currently overclocking at 46 times the core speed, which gives us a nominal speed of 4.692 gigahertz or 4.7 gigahertz. What I can do is I can perform a stress test to make sure that I can keep the temperature of the CPU under an acceptable limit, whatever limit I choose, given that clock speed. Now, stability is a separate issue. But temperature is one, you know, aspect of overclocking. I know that it's stable at 46. I've already tried it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to click on core, and it says warning, warning, warning. Yes, 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 fine, whatever. And you push this up to 47. Now, this is not going to make a permanent change to the core clock speed. This is going to temporarily overclock the CPU. If you find that it's stable, you need to go into the BIOS and you need to change the setting of the core clock there to make it a permanent change, okay? So we're going to apply that, and you'll see top right now it's saying default 4.692, proposed speed 4.794. So we're overclocking it up to 4.8 gigahertz. That's what we're doing. We could save that if you want as the 46 test. We'll do a 47 test. You can save that so you can load different stress testings back in. Temperature's just spiked up slightly there. It should come back under control. Currently running at 50 now, which is, it shouldn't be doing that right now. I suspect the CPU's being worked. CPU utilization, yeah, the CPU spike just went up there. So it's obviously busy doing something. So let's just give it a quick stress test. 5 minutes is normally enough. You can put this at whatever you like. I'm just gonna go for we'll go for a 3 minute stress test. Normally I would leave this, I ran this for an hour, soak testing it at 46 to make sure it was absolutely stable. So I'll do that after, you know, not now, but I'll do it later to make sure that at 47 this thing is stable and the water cooler can keep the temperature down. But if I click on start, watch these parameters here and watch that temperature. There you go, it's come back down to 38 now. So I click start. Straight away you're going to see this blue line coming up, CPU. So the CPU is flatlining at 100% or 98%. CPU temperature immediately started to rise, obviously. Now the fan has now increased in speed, but you can see what's happening on the temperature here. It's stabilizing in the range, and it's going to track the minimum and maximum. So the maximum hits 76, but that tends to be a little bit spiky because, and I'll show you in a second, you can control how quickly the fan picks up speed when it needs to cool down. And you can make it, at the moment it's set for 2.8 seconds. So that stops, you know, if you've got temporary CPU spikes, that stops the fan from picking up speed too quickly. It puts a little bit of a delay in it. And it's the same on the downside. When the fan needs to cool down, you can set how long it takes to cool down. It means that things don't just suddenly, you know, the fan doesn't suddenly go from spinning quietly to spinning very, very quickly and then back down again. It kind of gently goes up a bit like a slope, effectively. But you can see here, it's effectively, this is stable. What we're saying here is that the minimum is 34, the maximum is 77, the average is 51, but that's just an average. The current temperature is what we're looking at. Anything over about 75, we need to start getting a little bit concerned. If it can hold at 100% at 47 overclock, if it can hold that at around 75 degrees, that's probably fine. Anything over 80 is a big no-no. 75 is a reasonable, when you're overclocking, 75 is kind of where you want to be. I wouldn't propose to go to 48, I don't think. I probably could, but I don't want to stress the CPU either. And that, you know, stability is a big thing as far as I'm concerned. But you can see what's going on here, the green, the temperature's just going up and down as the fan compensates for it, to just keeping the temperature nice and idle. But yeah, you can see it's nice and stable, 4.8 gigahertz. It's overclocked from a core of 4 gigahertz. That's what it comes with out the box. But it's called a Devil's Canyon processor, this thing. It's pretty good, and you can overclock it quite nicely. Like I say, I could probably start to going towards 4.9, but it's getting a bit extreme at that point. 4.8 seems to be a happy medium. It should be able to do whatever I want to do with it, so that's all I'm really concerned about. 46 would possibly make your CPU life a little bit longer, but realistically, is it going to matter? Probably not. 47 clock seems to be a good place for me. So what I'll need to do is, when this is finished, I'll need to stress test this for about an hour just to make sure it's absolutely fine and set it into the BIOS to make sure it's permanent. But yeah, that basically that's passed, and it'll tell you it's passed. Certainly the CPU has never gone anywhere near 80 degrees and it doesn't have to do a thermal shutdown. So it's saying here the CPU stress test has passed. You can actually benchmark your system with this tool as well. You can play around with all the different settings. It's very detailed. It's the Intel Extreme Tuning Utility, and it's completely free from the Intel site. Just Google it. But the stress test is what I'm interested in. I've already done the memory stress test, so I'm not worried about that. But the CPU, yeah, 4.8 gigahertz. So that's it. I'm going to soak test this now, box it all back up, get the lid on, and we are done building this system. And there you have it, guys. That is the complete PC build, as promised. I've taken you through the whole thing from start to finish. Hopefully you understood it. Hopefully you've learned something. And if not, hopefully you find it interesting. This is the computer that is going to power me through 2015, which is, of course, Year of the Squirrel. If you've got any questions or comments about the build, please leave them in the video below, and I shall try to answer as many as I can. Until then, guys, take care, and I'll see you on the next video.